Hi, everybody, and welcome to Summer Forum this Sunday, August 15th. We are very, very excited for our forum today and for our guest. And we will have an exciting announcement relating to our guest for today towards the end of the presentation part. So super excited about that, and super excited to tell you all about that. So, but first, want to announce something else. And that is that Harold Strawn, a longtime member of our church and a longtime coordinator for the Summer Forum program, passed away just a little while ago. And his memorial service will be on Saturday, August 28th. So in a little bit less than 2 weeks at 11 a.m. And it will be conducted via Zoom. So at least certainly via Zoom will be an option that is available to everybody. And so, you know, we hope that as many of members of the congregation who would like to attend and are able to attend are able to do so then. And please spread the word as well. So very sad and sorry that that Harold is gone, but you know, we want to have a wonderful memorial service, and I'm certain we will in about 2 weeks. All right, so moving on to less serious matters, but not necessarily less important. Our speaker today, or our guest today, is Nancy Borgenicht, who is, among many other things, the longtime writer, director, creator, producer, force behind, and spirit of Saturday's Voyeur, which, if you haven't seen it in the last 42, 43 years that she has been producing it, it has been an absolute staple of theater in Salt Lake City, and a wonderful outlet and relief to all of those of us who live in Salt Lake City, who kind of have to put up with a lot of the dominant culture, even if it is not our own. And so Saturday's Voyeur has been a phenomenal parody, a phenomenal send-up, a phenomenal critique, and a phenomenally enjoyable way of living in Salt Lake City, and of processing and of making fun of and of enjoying our city and our state and our culture and the world in which we live. And so we're very, very happy that Nancy has joined us today and will be talking with us on Zoom today, and telling us about kind of the history of Saturday's Voyeur and basically what she's done with it, or at least a little bit about what she's done with it for the last 42, 43 years. So Jim Catano is going to be basically conducting the interview and asking your questions, but Nancy will be the star of the show. And along those lines, I'd like to say welcome, Nancy Borgenicht, and we look forward to having you here, and welcome to Summer Forum.
I believe I've seen fellow Unitarians at every Saturday's Voyeur performance I've ever attended. So we're, of course, honored to have actress, writer, director, and producer Nancy here today, Nancy Borgenicht. Nancy, are you ready for some probing questions?
Yeah.
Great.
You ready for your close-up?
Yeah, there's a, Nancy's got a delightful Pat Bagley cartoon here.
My smirking was off. I'm so sorry.
That's okay. Nancy, first, tell us a little bit about yourself and your background. How did you get involved in theater? What was your connection to Salt Lake and to Utah?
Well, I'm a native. My grandparents came from Russia, Poland in 1903, And though my mom was born here, my mom was always an actress in college and went to the Pasadena Playhouse for a while and was in many, many, many plays here at Pioneer under Robert Hyde Wilson. But my parents, my dad was a labor union lawyer and a fighter of the underdog in the Democratic Party. But he was also a radio announcer, and he did, in a way to get through law school, he did the Salt Lake Bees games, he announced, and he had a great imitation of FDR that he used one night through from KSL to the roof garden of the Hotel Utah, pretending he was FDR at a Rotary Club or some kind of meeting like that. Anyway, my parents were hysterical. And they did Voyeur, but they did it my mom called it the Temple Follies for the B'nai Israel Jewish Synagogue. My dad got her to do Follies for the Bar Association. I just grew up with them writing, especially my mother, taking the words to popular songs and changing them. And that was how I grew up. And I think in song. I myself was sent to Rowland Hall at the age of 14, and they had I loved Rowland Hall. Oh my God, it saved my life. But it was a girls' school then. They had a Halloween skits competition of the 9, 10, 11, 12 high school classes in 15, 20 minute skits. And I wrote my first skit there. We won it. No freshman class had ever won it. So I've been just doing this a long, long time. It's sort of, I think in song, they come to me and it's what I do.
So the very first Saturday's Voyeur, what were the particular foibles of Utah that year that prompted you to write that? Do you recall what the issues around that were?
Yeah, I recall it. I recall it very, very well. I was part of the Salt Lake Acting Company rented, Eliot Hall from 1970 to 1978 and performed there on like Thursday, Friday, Saturday, took sets down on Sunday. And a beautiful human being named Michael Butters was an actor there with me, as I was. I did plenty of plays there from about 74 on. And, it was community theater. It was Salt Lake Acting Company, but it was community theater, but great stuff. Michael was a return missionary, very funny man. And he had story after story of growing up Mormon and some sad stuff too. And I grew up here. I hadn't heard of them particularly, any of the specifics. And a song came to me one day in 1977. It was almost the entire first song I wrote for the first Saturday's Voyeur. It was, "We've got beneficial life. We've got Donnie and Marie. We've got California citrus you can pick right off a tree. We got KSL and ZC and the Deseret News. What ain't we got? We ain't got booze." And so I ran to Michael, who was selling shoes at Castleton's in Foothill. And I said, "We got to do this. We got to do this. We got to do this. We got to do your stories. I'll write the songs." So we spent a whole year, 77, interviewing his friends, some of my relatives who were Mormon or ex-Mormon, and we got people's stories. And it became a nothing is made up, these come from real people kind of piece that we put together as a roadshow, but roadshow was, do you know what roadshow is in this community? Yeah. So it was an hour long, and I remember inviting the board of SLAC at that time, which is mainly all actors, to my house. And Michael and I did it for them, did the whole thing. We said, you don't have to do, we'll do everything. We'll build the sets. We have people building it. We'll do everything. So they consented to do it. My parents thought their houses would be burned down. But they served bartenders at Eliot Hall. Anyway, it was an hour roadshow that was about the cultural life and cultural institutions of Mormonism, from the family to the mission to girls wanting to get married to the wedding. It was an hour long, but it all came out of real places. And Michael, for example, had been a missionary, so he had the entire missionary handbook, which in itself is a gold mine. And we worked on it for a year, and there it was. We did it in Eliot Hall. Oh, do you want to see the first flyer?
Absolutely.
It went viral before there was viral. Michael and I got in sort of wedding garb, and we went to the Hotel Utah to get our picture taken to spread, to pretend we were getting married in the, can you see it?
So that's you and Michael there, and yeah. ready to get married in the temple.
Ready to get married and invite everyone to attend our wedding on during the days of 47. And so can you see that his hand is on my left breast?
Up a little bit, we can, oh yeah, there we go. Very
good. So this went out to like 500 people that were on the mailing list that would come to SLAC shows. And apparently it just, people copied it and it went everywhere. And the thing was, we were only supposed to do like five performances or maybe five in 2 weeks. And it was packed and it was nuts and it kept extending and extending and extending. And there you have it.
That's wonderful. So I guess that was provided enough juice to make you want to do it again. Is that right? And so.
Well, it was funny because I thought it was a one-time thing. Michael left town and sadly died a number of years later, but did not, you know, live to see the extension of it. But Ed Griska, who was the artistic director of the theater at the time, said, well, we're doing this again. And I said, really? And we moved from Eliot Hall in 78 to a real theater. The theater in Above the Dead Goat at Aeropress Square, where Human Ensemble was there for years and years doing amazing theater. Allen Nevins was a part of Human Ensemble then. But they chose to break up. That space was empty. We got a real theater in 1979. And we were only there a few years because, like, if you couldn't find a parking place, you'd just keep driving. So, but Voyeur was there from 79 to 81.
So at a certain point, you said, this is working. This is flying. We're going to just make this an annual tradition.
Yeah, and I, after really the first year, I kept adding to it. So it got bigger and bigger and longer based on the news of what was current and what had happened. So like the opening prayer, we always had an opening prayer and asked everyone to pray with us. And I would add like, please watch over us and protect us from the ACLU and Planned Parenthood, or we'd say, you know, so there would be additions to whatever was in the news. And then like I added a scene for the first year in Aeropress Square where LaDawn, the daughter, goes to the Y. So we see her at the Y, hoping to join the young ambassadors and making progressive dinners for Tongan students and cheese rolls. And her friend, Joyce McKinney, who was real, do you remember her?
Oh yeah, the capture the missionary and have sex with him, Joyce McKinney?
And, well, I don't know if she had sex with him, but she definitely captured him, kidnapped him in London She was a Mormon convert at BYU and unaccepted. So we brought her back and had her sing, it was, you know, Don't Cry for Me, Provo, Utah. And LaDon's best friend, Modine Mortensen, had just been testified with electric shock in front of the BYU secret police for something or other. So it was those additions that through the years, we kept adding on depending on what happened. Jake Garn in Space, the Jarvik Heart, the end of the Hotel Utah was a huge 20-minute segment. I was so angry about the Hotel Utah.
So how did you and Alan break up your creative duties? How did that flow, ebb and flow work?
Well, Al didn't join me writing until 1990. So the Voyeur stayed the same structurally from 1978 to 1995. He joined me in 1990. So these changes, I turned it into a Christmas show in 1985 with a 20-minute, what do you call it? What's the, a Voyeur ballet, We're the Chuck-O-Rama Milkmaids, a Christmas, what's the Christmas? The Nutcracker.
The Nutcracker,
yeah, that was a favorite. But by 1990, that was the final one at Voyeur because I decided I'd gifted it to them long enough and I wanted to be paid. And they decided they'd write their own and booted me. So Al had joined me in 90 for that last one that was at SLAC and said, well, that's the end of it. And he said, no, we'll find a place to take it. And we took it to Green Street, Bob Slingerland at Green Street, and it played there for 2 years. It should have played for three, but SLAC basically went bankrupt. and we were called back there by the board of trustees of SLAC to, we're gonna shut the doors, will you help us? And we said, if you shut the doors, it'll be done forever. Of course, we'll help you. So Al and I then took over the theater from 93 to 2005.
So you were in an executive producer position at that point, right? At the theater.
Exactly. And ran the theater, brought it back, and wrote Voyeur every year, but Al actually realized in 1996 was the Enid Green Voyeur. Phantom of the Opera had come to town and it was this huge deal with enormous press and people going nuts buying tickets. It was here for a month. And the Enid Green Joel Walholt story was huge. And so we took that using all this music from Phantom of the Opera and we embedded Ina in the family. There were more children and she grew up Republican and we did this. There were scalpers wanting tickets. It was funny. But Al said, it showed us people will go with us wherever we take them. And it was packed. And clearly people would think they'd seen it for that many years. We need to do this differently every year. So that's when we rewrote it every year, brand new. And we really, by 2005, it was too hard to do it both, run the theater and write Voyeur new every year. So we passed the baton in 2005 and just wrote Voyeur until now.
Have there ever been years where we here in Utah have just been too normal and you've had to struggle for material to write about, or has there always been ample idiosyncrasies? you can play off of?
Yes, always ample idiocy. However, often the same. But, you know, it got hard. The first chunk of years with Al and from 93 on, people still read the newspaper. And so we took it all from public information and put it together in a way that people would say, well, you have to be smart to see Voyeur. You have to have read the newspaper. When people stopped reading the newspaper, when was that?
Yeah, that's a real tragedy, right?
It was a tragedy. It got hard.
So do you, I guess, have you in recent years had to go to the internet or other sources to discover material that's universally appealing, or how does that process go?
Still, you know, there's news out there, and we tried very hard keeping it local for a long time, but you can only do the legislature for so long, you know, certainly with Mitt running for president and with Obama as president and those years of it started in 2005 with the Iraq War. That was not a funny year, and it was hard to be funny, and we couldn't, in all honesty, be funny. So we did a rap version of what we were going through in that war. Mm-hmm. Some people thought it should go to Broadway, and some people just said, that's enough of hurting George Bush, enough. But it became more national after that all the time. And then it just became more national, and it still was placed here very much. And whatever was happening here, we found a way to use it, because of course there was still news, but it was different.
Have you ever identified a particular year that was particularly fun, that was just was rife with funny, just rich humor?
Well, I hate to say this, but it was always funny with rich humor. I mean, I think probably the audience liked some more than others, perhaps. It would be a good question to ask your audience. Yeah. I mean, I had certainly had some favorite numbers there. We did, I think it was 2002, when Laverkin wanted out of the UN, and it was the BLM and terrorists and people hating the federal government, and we went to Laverkin, and the Vagina Monologues was supposed to play, I think, in St. George, and they shut it down. And so this was a very Southern Utah experience with a song from Moulin Rouge about the Vagina Monologues, where essentially I named every part of the female anatomy after, like, the everything in Zion Park. I call mine the Ark of the Patriarchs. I call mine the Temple of Sinewawa. I don't know. The choreographic number for it, I just would wet my pants every time I saw it. But anyway.
I'm gonna get personal here. I think I had a favorite character, and that was about 3 or 4 years ago. I think you used him over the course of 2 years. That was Joseph Smith.
Yeah.
The actor looked exactly like Joseph Smith as paint in paintings. And
yeah.
Do you have a favorite character or someone who you was kind of a go-to person that loved?
Robert Scott Smith was just great, wasn't he?
Amazing.
He was just great. And it was a continuing character for a number of years because, you know, then everything came out. First of all, he took over the Hotel Utah. He was a statue that came to life many times. And then the scandalous information that came out about how many 14-year-old girls he really married. And he was just great. We used him and used him and used him. And in a sort of an ecumenical way with Moses, with the Pope, with Buddha, he was a great character. There were many actors that were in Voyeur over and over and over again who either followed their characters or they were in it a lot because they were so multi-dimensional. They just always amazed us. And when we have auditions, they'd walk in the door. Thank you, God.
Did you stay in touch with a lot of these folks and have many reunions?
Well, you know, we used to celebrate, who knew it was going to go on this long? So when the 10th anniversary ended up, we did a kind of a retrospective, and there were cameos. Frank Layden was in it. And a lot of the actors stayed a long time, Becky Meacham, Mark Chambers, almost 20 years. A number of actors went off to New York, and certainly we stay in touch with many, but not all. I've lost touch with, 42 years, it's over 1,000 actors.
Wow. So how about a song? Is there a favorite song? One that you think could have been up there in Lights?
In Lights? Broadway? I don't know about that. I don't know about Lights, but I'd kind of like There's No Erection in the Resurrection on my tombstone. I like that song. I don't know if you want me to sing it for you or not.
if you're game, we're listening.
Well, it just came out of such an interesting place. It was a first year song. And
did you resolve how spirit children are born without that particular?
Well, no, it was more. It was more about that if you mess around in this life with your wife or husband, it's about the husbands really. Because they can continue procreating worlds beyond. But if they mess around, their procreative sexual organs would not be resurrected with them. So that was the prayer at the wedding. There's no erection in the resurrection. I don't think I should sing it.
Okay.
I did sing it at Polly Nevins' wedding party, but that was enough.
So in the time,
we're not dead. We haven't been killed. It's a great sign for really the openness of the Mormon Church. I think never once. I think we helped them. We certainly helped the perception of Utah. People who from out of town would come and they would say, "How do they let you do this?" And we would say, "This is America."
So over these past four decades, when you haven't been doing Saturday's Voyeur, has this occupied you 24/7, 365? What else do you have on your plate?
Well, no, this is 24/7 every day of your life, reading 3-4 newspapers a day, finding and making piles of articles that interest you or things that happen. This is full on every day. But from 93 to 2005, when Al and I ran the theater and brought it back to life, and he with his own hands rebuilt the main stage theater and built the chapel theater and refurbished the whole place and did amazing theater We became an equity theater. Actors got paid decently. Health insurance. We got grants to Julie Jensen from the $100,000 grant to the Pew Foundation for Julie Jensen. We did all her plays. We supported new. I mean, it was full out. J.T. Rogers thought SLAC was his home. We commissioned and produced four of his plays. He won a Tony for Oslo a few years ago. We did major theater, and then it was just clear it was too hard to do both. So that was, so it's been Voyeur only from 2005 on, and it is hard.
So
sometimes it's only fun. So I usually can make myself laugh. Al, I'm sure we don't write it together. We discuss together. We decide what's important to say, and we go into our own offices and corners, and we edit each other. But the fun comes from the rehearsals and the play and seeing it done. And the fun comes only from the audience. Only from the audience validates what this is, and only from the audience that kept this going.
Does it ever evolve during rehearsals? Do cast members ever contribute ditties or suggestions that get incorporated, or are you guys pretty much taskmasters?
Pretty much taskmasters. Okay. There's certainly editing going on with their rehearsals that we used to direct it to all the time. But of course there's give and take, and there are cuts and there's fixes, and we're certain open to anything funny. But I know so many people think the actors write it.
Yeah, they do get all the credit, seems like, in the movies too.
You know, we're amorphous characters in it. We're not, we're just names. But there are a lot of cuts with actors wanting to know, can this be better, that kind of thing goes on all the time, how to fix it, because it's design build. We auditioned in January for something that's not written yet. We know what it's gonna be by January. So it's a leap of faith for these actors, you know, and it's an amazing process for them.
Let's jump forward to current times, COVID forward. Can you tell us what has been the evolution of Voyeur during that time frame and where it is currently stands?
Well, of course, it was almost all written by 2019 because rehearsals start in May of 2020. Sorry, it was written almost fully written in 2020, and rehearsals start in May, so that it was canceled in May. Clearly, there couldn't be a Voyeur. But a couple weeks after it was canceled, Al and I got notice from the Board of Trustees and Cynthia Fleming that it was canceled forever. They wanted to go another direction. It was upsetting. Of course, Voyeur had to end sometime. And we're getting old, who knows? But after 42 years, I really thought we would have been part of the conversation. They did want to honor us with a gala when it was safe together. And we said, no, thank you. When it's safe together, do one more Voyeur and say goodbye to the 42 years of audience that kept this alive with grace, and they said no. So that was the end of it. But
let's get to the butt. What are you doing? Tell us what you're doing right now.
When the election happened in 2020, and it was so stressful it was trauma living with Donald Trump for so long, and the last 4 years of Voyeur were all about Donald Trump and would Biden win, would he not? I just started writing songs through COVID to get through COVID. They would come to me and they fed me, and I had no intention of doing anything with them but singing them to myself. But I got through COVID by writing songs. And we Al and I had both let it go. But I got this email flyer from Stephen Brown, SB Dance. Have you ever seen him out of the Rose Wagner? Just a beautiful avant-garde dance company. He brought dance into people's driveways last year for free. And he said, it was so moving, live perform. It was, so he sent a flyer saying he was doing it again this year. And his stage was bigger, and it just sparked me. And I said, I just wrote 10 songs. I know how to put this together and take this to the yards of Voyeur friends and family that we didn't get to say thank you to. So I'm doing that.
So tell us a little bit about this. Is it a 35 minute show? Is that how long it runs? 35 to 40 minutes?
It actually runs close to an hour. So I called it a road show again. But there's a lot of give and take with the audience in terms of their memories and with the performers who all have Voyeur histories. The 10 songs themselves do take about 35 minutes, but the whole thing, it's a whole thing. That's a thank you and goodbye is what it is.
And you've done this how many times now this summer? Backyards?
We've done it in 10 backyards so far, and we have 16 more bookings and through September, and they're still coming.
Let's give a plug right now for our upcoming booking. And the congregation will be delighted to know that on Saturday, August 28th at 8 p.m., we will be having a performance as close to Eliot Hall as you can get in this time of COVID. And that's right outside on what will be currently Goldsmith Plaza, with social distancing and an audience that's limited to 50 people. We will be, Nancy and her company will be gracing us with one of the final performances of Saturday's Voyeur, and looking forward to people going to Eventbrite. And I think Dylan is going to be posting.
I will jump in here real quick. Saturday's Voyeur began at Eliot Hall. It began at our church and as a road show. And so we think it is only appropriate and wonderful that it should, if not end, the final performance, the final road show of Saturday's Voyeur will also be at our church. So as close to Eliot Hall as we can get, it will be at right outside at Goldsmith Plaza, and it will be on Saturday, August 28th. So the road show is coming back. It's coming back home, if you will, where it all began for the night of Saturday, August 28th at 8 p.m. It'll be out on Goldsmith Plaza. And as Jim said, the tickets are, we're going to have 50 tickets available for it, and it is going to be a fundraiser for the church. So the tickets are $20 each, and there will actually be sort of an entr'acte with some members of our church, a couple songs that they've put together before the main show of Saturday's Voyeur in about 2 weeks. So tickets can be purchased on Eventbrite. And we actually have a link that you can do so right here that I'm going to be sharing over the chat in just a minute. So you can purchase tickets to it starting today. As I mentioned, there will only be 50 tickets available, so get them while you can. And we are super excited to be bringing Saturday's Voyeur back to the Unitarian Church. Welcome. Welcome back, everybody. And as I said, we are opening it up to questions from the audience. So if any of you have any questions for Nancy about Saturday's Voyeur and the last, 42, 43 years that that it's been going on, my goodness, that would, you know, let us know and we will answer. I actually have a question. You touched on this a little bit at the beginning, but it sounds like, so when Saturday's Voyeur began, was it a story, is that right? It was a particular story. It wasn't necessarily built around the, you know, the news events of the previous year or anything like that. So can you tell us maybe a little bit about the story? And then you said around the mid-90s, it changed to be more around the news events of the year because of both, you know, Phantom of the Opera coming to Utah and Enid Greenwaldholt saga.
Well, that's true. I think that's the right assessment. There was always an opening prayer, and that had a lot of news in it that was current. And each year it expanded to include more news as an encore within the structure of Family Home Evening, the mission, young girls wanting to marry a missionary, and the wedding. So that essentially stayed the same, but and the characters and actors stayed in it. So it became sort of like a series, a sitcom in a way. You followed these actors, but I mean, even from what I told you about the addition of the LaDon goes to BYU scene, it was very political. So it stayed in that structure and was added to, and then it became a totally all new thing after 96.
Did you ever think about revisiting, or did you ever revisit the sort of the original characters or some of the original cast in the years after 96?
Well, the 40th anniversary, we found a way to merge the original with the new one. So yes.
Mm-hmm. Was there a year that was the I remember, I think the Fat Man of the Opera was the song, right? For instead of the Fat Phantom of the Opera, the Fat Man of the Opera. I remember when I was in high school, you know, my parents coming home and just raving about it and saying, was there a year that was particularly notable for being popular?
I think that was
that probably the one?
That was absolutely off the charts and a turning point. It was so much in the news for so long and so huge. Karen Shepherd, that beautiful congresswoman, brilliant, just called the Pinocchio, and the fraud of these people, the corruption. It was a huge story, and it people loved it to be reminded of it that way. And so that was a big change for us.
And you decide, hey, you got something working there, you know, just keep going with it. Yeah.
Jim's question about was it ever hard sometimes to find, I mean, certainly you didn't get stories like that every year. So yes, it was hard to keep finding material after material when there wasn't some big thing. It was really hard. Mm-hmm. And maybe I didn't answer his question right because I wanted to forget it. I don't know. It was hard, but yeah.
Hey, Nancy, this is Becky.
Hi.
Hi.
Oh, my saliva sister.
You were obviously a great mentor and a great, you paved the way for women to get up there and sing parody and say things that sometimes weren't always appropriate. And I always thank you for that, Nancy.
Oh, that is so good. Well, I think between the two of us, we opened up.
We got into a lot of trouble.
We opened up the town in terms of self-censorship. That was the worst. The self-censorship of everyone was... Absolutely. You know, way to go, Becky.
Well, way to go, Nancy. I have to tell you, the first time I saw Saturday's Warrior at Aeropress Square. So it was at the very beginning, and I was barely coming out of my own Mormon experience and deciding to do other things. And when, who was it that had, it was the father that did the opening prayer, folded his arms and started to pray.
Yeah.
I just gasped, you know, all my residual Mormonism is going,
Then
I took a deep breath and I said, I'm going with this. I'm just gonna go with this. And I kind of went with it for the rest of my life, Nancy. So thank you.
That's so good.
Well, you two are gonna be able to share the stage on the upcoming performance because Becky's putting together the entree act. So.
Oh, beautiful.
Well, with a lot of help.
Beautiful.
You got our fingers crossed, it's gonna be okay.
Well, that's just beautiful. That's so beautiful. So,
all right.
We have some other questions. So let me. I'm gonna go ahead and read those, Nancy, and you can feel those as I read them. Number one, Kate remembers fondly an ingenue from Davis County, but she also asks, "Did the musical, The Book of Mormon, throw a spanner? I guess it means that's a wrench. I guess did that in any way alter the way you approached Saturday's Warrior?"
Not at all. I certainly listened to the music from it, and we stole from it a couple times when they were here.
The cast, I understand, some of the cast came to see a performance, and they just loved it.
I don't know. I feel quite sure that the writers were doing research for it, which they worked on for over 8 years, saw Voyeur and realized how funny dancing missionaries really were. I mean, absolutely. But we had many of our audience say ours is better. And I think that's because we live with them and they didn't. Mm-hmm. But it certainly was a great piece of theater and a great boon to the Mormon church in many ways. But yeah, no, did not affect our box office, did not affect the loyalty. And many, many people saw it. And it was so great. I just didn't have the money. It was so great to, I didn't want to spend the money. That's what I it was so great to hear from people that we like yours better. So that was
Donnie says, my favorite song was sung in bathing suits over garments. Hilarious. that prompts the question, did you ever catch any static officially from the church over anything?
Never.
Interesting.
Never. And that was another moment that, you know, was shocking, but we certainly didn't use real ones. That helped. And did you see the article in the New York Times last week? And I think it was on Doug Fabrizio about sacred garments. Are the women aren't liking them now? They're itching and getting rashes, and it's not good. Did you see it, Becky?
I did. Yeah.
Well, that's an instance where I'm like, well, that's a song, and I know exactly. I know exactly, and I'm saving it. There it is.
Rick Sandak says, "Hi, Nancy. I'm crying. I'm laughing out of joy for the gift you gave the community. So lucky to be your brother."
Oh, was that Rick?
Will you please share the Misha Gass story?
Oh, yeah. I couldn't remember. I called him. I was trying to remember how funny my parents were And they would do things like they'd send out a fancy invitation that a famous Russian violinist was coming to their home to play, and would you please attend and wear, you know, very formal clothing. And his name is Misha Goss. And that's a Yiddish word for, this is such a mess. And people showed up. Anyway, I thank you, Rick. Rick's the funniest one in the family. No, my sister Susan's the funniest one in the family. Rick comes next, then maybe me.
This is from Barbara Taylor. She says, lately it seems you've had more political and less Mormon themes. I really enjoyed the Mormon themes. Is there a reason why you have shifted?
We just did a road show in her garden. And so she's just seen the most recent one. It's sort of guided by the news. The news makes it. And it's guided by our sort of feelings and anger of what pisses us off the most. And it's not intentional. Like, I could hardly wait to write the song about the Mormon garments.
It was pretty hard to ignore Trump these past 4 years. That's for
sure. Yeah, you can't. And certainly the support of, there was great hope that many Mormon women especially would not vote for him this election. Mitt, who we sort of didn't really think could save the Constitution from hanging by a thread in when he was nominated and ran, turns out to be our hero now. And, you know, Mormons should not have voted for Trump. That's in the new one, but that's as far as we go. And also, I feel like we're an equal opportunity, attacker.
Tim and Kathy Chambliss say, over the years, have you ever had communication from legislators or law enforcement officials calling for censorship of your content? If not, where has that come from?
Never. Well, one. The people that do clean flicks that out of Provo that choose to edit out of a film that doesn't belong to them unappealing content, we flipped out on that one and wrote a song, and they sent a nasty letter. That was as far as it got. We have never been censored. Never. It's pretty great. We've been sent many letters of sort of criticism, but we've never been shut down or censored by any legal anything.
Well, you won't be censored at the First Unitarian Church on Saturday the 28th. Encourage everyone to get their tickets. We have exhausted our hour and are so delighted. Nancy, thank you so very much. And
May I say one thing? First of all, we in this roadshow are all vaccinated. Secondly, the Unitarians from Eliot Hall on have been so supportive of not just Saturday's Voyeur, but of always of the Salt Lake Acting Company. And you are just the most amazing, wondrous group of people ever, ever, ever. So thank you for all of it. And thank you for this. Thank you so much for this.
The love is mutual, and we will not make you wear masks on Saturday the 28th, okay?
That would be wise.
Dylan?
They're loud though.
All right, so thank you everybody for joining us for Summer Forum today, and thank you so much, Nancy, for joining us today and for being part of our community and an essential part of sort of the subculture of Salt Lake City and Utah for all of these years. I know that
Can I tell one more story?
Please. Yeah.
It was when I was called to ask, would I do this, by Don Walton. And I told him, he said, would I be a speaker? And I told him what we were doing. That was maybe the first time you all heard it. And he immediately said, oh, do it here. Do it here. Do it where it started. We could do it in the sanctuary. It was like, you are kidding me. These Unitarians are just the best. We can do this in the sanctuary. Anyway, it was a good one.
Yeah, no, I mean, seems a no-brainer to us. So this is real, real easy call. So
I said, you better come see it first.
Remember. So yeah, I did see it. Nancy insisted that before we agreed to do it, we check it out to make sure that it would be okay for everybody. And of course it was. I knew it would be. I was just excited to see the performance. So it's fantastic. And we encourage everybody. We hope that everyone's able to join us on the 28th and for sort of a farewell Saturday's Voyeur and a thank you back at the Unitarian Church where it all began.